exciting evening for us in the archive project, because there's nothing we like to do better than being able to highlight the life and work of key historic figures whose contributions have either been largely, if not totally, forgotten, or simplified down to one signature episode, thus ignoring a lifetime of wonderful accomplishments. The stories of these civic giants are the intellectual capital of civic activism. They inform, instruct, and inspire us. They remind us that David can be Goliath on occasion, that visionary ideas can indeed become reality, usually after many, many years, and that fighting the good fight for a more livable city, win or lose, is an honorable New York tradition. So tonight, we are lifting up the life and work of the great civic giant George McAneny. Now, if you've heard of him, you likely know him as the borough president who unsuccessfully tried to save the historic St. John's Chapel, or as the victor over Robert Moses in the decade-long battle to save Castle Clinton, or as the persuasive president of the American Scenic and Historic Preservation Society. And if that's how you've heard of him, then you've only heard one small piece and one insight into the complex genius of George McAneny. Confronted by the absence of scholarly work that was singularly focused on him, and in light of his importance to the story of preservation and planning in New York City, the Archive Project commissioned historian Charles Starks to focus his talents and energy on bringing to life that fuller story of McAneny's role in shaping the city. Charles started in our life as a research fellow at the New York Preservation Archive Project. He actually began 4 years ago with us while he was still an intern for us as a graduate student at Columbia. Now, 4 years later, he teaches urban studies at Hunter College. He holds a master's degree in regional studies from Columbia University and in city planning from Georgia Tech. His talk tonight is based on his recently completed monograph, New York's Pioneer of Planning and Preservation, How George McAneny Reshaped Manhattan and inspired a movement, which we were lucky enough to be able to commission. He's co-author of An Administrative History of Fire Island National Seashore, and he's also worked as a planner in New Jersey, Toronto, and New York, though we don't hold that against him in any way. Thanks to his meticulous analysis of McAneny's own papers, his probing explorations into archival collections, and his careful combing of existing scholarship, and his passion for the subject, Charles has connected the puzzle pieces and constructed the fullest picture yet of this great New Yorker, and this monograph is now available on our website. So after tonight, you can go home and spend the rest of the evening going even deeper into his accomplishments. Now, I've heard the story, and I don't know if it's true, that McAneny's daughter, the formidable Ruth McAneny Loud, who for years was a major force at the Musical Arts Society, that she was so protective of her father's legacy and so dedicated to having his story told exactly the right way that the unintended consequence was that he never got the biography that he deserved. Well, tonight we take an important step in addressing that wrong. After Charles's presentation, he and I will be joined by Michael Miscione for a brief conversation about McAneny. Now, Michael is a native New Yorker, a professional tour guide, and a historical activist. In 2006, he was appointed Manhattan Borough Historian, usually identifying as Manhattan Borough President, which is problematic. And a role he's still playing today. And he's well known for his ongoing efforts to raise awareness for Andrew Haswell Green, a forgotten, not totally thanks to his work, 19th century master planner, reformer, and preservationist. In one sense, tonight's panel might be seen as a historical seance with three great overlapping historic civic figures, McAneny, Green, and Bard, being channeled by their contemporary champions. Be still your beating hearts. That's anyway, before we get there, we're going to have Charles's presentation, so please join me in welcoming Charles to the podium.
Thank you very much, Tony. this has been a long time coming, and it's so apropos to be able to talk about George McAneny in this building, on this site, which he cherished, and he was a prime mover in making it into a museum back in 1939. I don't know how many of you have ever noticed on the ground floor of this building, there's a plaque that reads, George McAneny, pioneer in city planning, protector of historic places, leader of a city, and friend beyond compare. This plaque was placed there in 1956, 3 years after he died. Its placement here in this building gives us some sense of how important this particular place, out of all the places that he touched in New York City, was to him. It's rare these days to find someone who knows more than a few of the things that McAneny did, and rarer still to encounter anyone who knows how important he was, not only to the city of New York, but what a pioneer he was to the fields of both preservation and planning. Tonight, we hope to begin a process of bringing George McAneny back into the conversation by providing an overview of the full sweep of his career as a city planner and a preservationist. There are two caveats. First, McAneny's opus is massive, so we can't stay here all night, so this is going to be a whirlwind tour. Second, although I've been studying for a little while now, I certainly don't claim to know everything there is to know about George McAneny, so I'm interested in hearing from any members of the audience who have knowledge they would like to share, and you can email me at the address, which is on the first slide, which I will try to go back to right now. And here's the plaque on the ground floor. Everyone should take a look at it if you can as you leave. Now, George McAneny was born in 1869 in Greenville, New Jersey, which at the time was a suburb of Jersey City. And Greenville is highlighted on this map, which now is part of Jersey City, but at that time was a suburb of Jersey City. And his father, George McAneny Sr., was a newspaper reporter and an editor and a town clerk. His mother was an important figure in local charity work. In 1885, he graduated from Jersey City High School, and this was the end of his formal education. It's not clear why he didn't attend college. Perhaps he simply sought adventure, because shortly thereafter, he followed in his father's footsteps and started working as a reporter for New Jersey and New York City newspapers, and eventually for Harper's Weekly, which was edited by the abolitionist and civil service reformer George William Curtis. McAneny must have been able to make himself at ease in high society, because the beat that these newspapers assigned him was the summer and winter resorts of socialites scattered around the eastern United States, from Asheville, North Carolina, to Saratoga Springs, New York. And in 1892, while he was reporting for Harper's Weekly from Virginia, an associate of Curtis sent him a telegram offering him a job as a secretary of the National Civil Service Reform League. He decided to accept the position, and as a newspaper would later describe it, hitch his wagon to the star of reform. George William Curtis died that same year in 1892, and Carl Schurz, another reformer and political leader of the German-American community, took over from him as chairman of the League. Schurz took McAneny under his wing. He introduced him to New York political circles at his summer home in Bolton Landing on Lake George in upstate New York. It was there that McAneny met the woman who would become his wife, Marjorie Jacoby, the daughter of the prominent pediatricians Abraham and Mary Putnam Jacoby. And it may have also been at Lake George that McAneny first met the lawyer Edward M. Shepard, who owned a large mansion up there, which is still exists. In 1902, Shepard hired McAneny to work in his law office, where he worked as a lobbyist, traveling back and forth to Albany and Philadelphia on behalf of Shepard's client, the Pennsylvania Railroad, which at that time was seeking approval from the state legislature to construct Penn Station and its massive network of connecting railways throughout the region and throughout the city. And it was from this experience, McAneny said, that he obtained many of his ideas about city planning. In 1906, McAneny was hired away from Edward Shepard's office to be the president of the City Club, a reform group that had been founded a decade and a half earlier. This period was probably the height of the City Club's influence on the government of New York City. It was engaged in a dizzying array of activities, usually in concert with other civic organizations, to try to bring reform to the municipal administration and to change the built environment of the city. In 1908, McAneny's City Club sponsored an exhibit on city planning as part of the exhibition on the congestion of population at the American Museum of Natural History. It was programmed by Mary Sinkovich, the Settlement House reformer, and Benjamin Marsh, a crusading journalist. The exhibition, which was followed by a more well-known conference in Washington, D.C. the next year, was a unique cross-pollinization of socialist, neighborhood improvement, and business interests that essentially birthed the modern American field of city planning. So coming out of these exhibitions and conferences was the idea that a city planner could be a coordinator between multiple technical and political interests, and that municipal government, led by a technocratic administration, would take a more active role in transforming the city than it had ever done before. The planner's role was one for which George McAneny was well suited, having been a reformer of long standing, president of the City Club, and having technical expertise in city planning from his work with Shepherd on the railroad. So he soon got the chance to act not as just an outside reformer, an outside agitator, but as a planner and a power broker. In 1909, thanks to a corruption investigation that the City Club and its allies had undertaken, many of the leading figures of the city administration who were associated with Tammany Hall had been charged with crimes. So the time was ripe for an electoral revolution, and McAneny and several other candidates ran as a cross-party fusion slate in the municipal elections that fall. With the exception of Tammany Mayor Gaynor, the major offices were filled with fusionites who could collectively run the office. And we can see McAneny on the right over here, George William Pendergrast, the comptroller is one of the other figures in this photo. McAneny's position on the Board of Estimate, together with John Roy Mitchell and Prendergast and the other borough presidents, essentially allowed him to control the city's planning and budgeting agenda. Even though he wasn't the mayor, he exerted as much influence as a mayor really would have. And once in office, McAneny immediately signaled that he was going to take municipal government in a very new direction of efficiency and modernization. So the first major project that McAneny undertook was a program to take the old streets of Manhattan and widen them by removing architectural encroachments into the public right-of-way, like stoops, railings, areaways, terraces, and to narrow the sidewalks and widen the vehicular roadways. And so this is kind of showing its effect on Fifth Avenue. This is pre-widening Fifth Avenue, quite a narrow street. Lots of stoops and architectural features are extending out into the public right-of-way. And then post-widening, it becomes sort of the commercial thoroughfare that we have become, looks a little more familiar to us. So this program was hardly friendly to preservation. It removed many structures that reduced the richness of the architecture. It also, by narrowing the sidewalks, reduced the richness of the city's street life. It flattened the appearance of the buildings. In McAneny's words, the buildings in general are taking on a more modern dress. And the avenues have acquired an aspect of increased beauty and utility. And you can decide which one you think is more beautiful and useful. But not everybody agreed with this. And in some neighborhoods, protests sprang up. Newspapers noticed that on Lower Second Avenue, slated for a widening that would narrow its sidewalks and eliminate a series of outdoor beer gardens, the stress is all on the human side. They have time to eat, even at noonday, time to frequent open-air cafes, to stroll, and to make love. But all that is because traffic has not invaded their paradise down on the Lower East Side. A coalition of churches and charities in the neighborhood organized to lodge a formal complaint and take their case to the press. The Board of Estimate paid the neighborhood protesters no heed. At a public hearing, McAneny decried what he termed as the inequitable distribution of space devoted to pedestrian traffic and vehicular traffic on Lower Second Avenue, by which he meant that too much space was devoted to pedestrians and not enough space was devoted to vehicles. So he argued that property owners would benefit from improved vehicular access, although that was cold comfort to the owners of this restaurant, Cafe Boulevard, one of the most storied restaurants on the avenue, which lost its front terrace and went out of business within 2 years of the wife. McAneny pursued an even more destructive plan in Greenwich Village. One of his principal efforts while in office was to complete negotiations with the Interborough Rapid Transit Company and the Brooklyn Rapid Transit Company, later known as the Brooklyn and Manhattan, or BMT, to undertake a massive subway expansion. To McAneny, the subway negotiations were key to replanning the city. If you could build enough lines to undeveloped land out of the boondocks, you could decongest the inner city slums and move people out by building new housing to a high standard in the outer boroughs. But you needed rapid transit going out there to do it. And the subway companies didn't want to run trains to empty land. What they wanted was to run subways in already congested areas where they would make more money from fares. So they demanded new lines in Manhattan, and one of the most important lines to them was what is now the 7th Avenue subway, which was designed to link downtown to the newly opened Penn Station, McAneny's former client. The most direct route for this line would go right through the middle of Greenwich Village, and the city saw an opportunity to achieve both surface and underground efficiency by ramming a wide extension to 7th Avenue, which then went no farther south than 11th Street through the middle of the neighborhood to catch the new subway line. So back at this time, 7th Avenue basically stopped right around here at 11th Street in Greenwich. And the city planned an extension that would run from A to B through a very dense cluster of tenements and older buildings, and then would substantially widen Barrack Street to go further south, to go further downtown. This extension destroyed at least 250 buildings, housing thousands of mostly working class households and lodgers. And according to the New York Times, it cut the heart out of Greenwich Village. It also destroyed two historic churches. McAneny was also making waves on Fifth Avenue in the 40s and 50s, where the architectural embellishments of famous Gilded Age mansions of the Vanderbilts and Huntingtons were being shattered to make way for a wider avenue and more traffic and commerce. In fall 1911, a newspaper declared the avenue, which had been changed from something that looked like this to sort of a more commercialized space with the walls and large entrances on the Gilded Age mansions removed, and an area full of traffic. The newspaper declared this avenue to have become a sad wreck. And in response, McAneny launched a committee to plan a new Fifth Avenue that would be, in his words, one of the most beautiful streets in the world. What raised a storm on Fifth Avenue was not so much the increase in traffic, really, or even the change from residences that was happening from residences to commerce, but the types of businesses that were steadily marching up the avenue from downtown. Manufacturers that occupied tall, thin buildings that when they were standing on their own, they maybe seemed all right, but once these get sort of side by side, there's very little light and air that can penetrate the interior of those buildings, and they can only be used for factories, housing sweatshops. And property owners feared that has happened so many times in the past. The emerging neighborhood of wealthy families and high-end shops would be destroyed by the march of these factories that brought hordes of immigrant workers streaming into the streets, causing ladies to run in fear during lunch hour. And a Save New York campaign was launched in the newspapers to try to use moral suasion to drive away the factories. But the property owners also had a sympathetic ear in the municipal administration. McAneny's committee recommended a height limit on the avenue. But his real aim was to create a zoning law that would stabilize not just one street, but property values all over the city and provide rational expansion in the areas that were being newly opened up by the subways. So McAneny commissioned a committee of the Board of Estimate to work out a zoning ordinance. They hired the best technical experts available. And by 1916, the city had secured enabling legislation from the state and its new zoning resolution. For this reason, George B. Ford, one of the experts that the administration hired, who went on to write zoning laws all over the United States, later called McAneny the father of zoning in this country. But as McAneny saw it, his work was far from complete. He wanted a permanent technical city planning function that could chart a long-term course for the city. What the zoning law did is that it created the possibility of a streetscape that looked like this in places where its height limits and setbacks mandated buildings that left space for light and air. But what was missing was really a coordination between the overall zoning and the transportation and education and health and so on needs that the city was going to have. So McAneny created a committee on the city plan as a function of the Board of Estimate. And he tried to find opportunities to use this committee to demonstrate the possibility of planning in the city. Now, ironically, actually, the insensitively planned 7th Avenue extension created a crisis. It gave him a small but unusual chance to demonstrate the possibility of planning, and it centered on historic preservation of all things. This building, St. John's Chapel, which was built in 1807, extended into what was going to be the widened Varick Street, the southern end of that extension of 7th Avenue for the subway. And specifically, its portico was right where the street was going to go. And the congregation of this building, this chapel, had already been dissolved, and it was empty, basically. A band of architects and philanthropists had come together to try to save it. So McAneny referred the problem that was created here to his committee on the city plan, which hosted a series of meetings between all the parties. And in 1914, they reached a breakthrough. McAneny agreed to recommend that the Board of Estimate to authorize $15,000 to modify the subway to maintain the chapel's pillars during subway construction. A citizens committee led by the architect I.M. Phelps Stokes, pledged to raise $6,000 to remove the stone platform steps in front of the building. And the chapel's owner, Trinity Church, agreed to maintain it for at least 2 years to give the committee a chance to find a new site for the building. If it had held, this agreement would have been a landmark in the annals of historic preservation in the city. A public-private partnership to save a structure that was expected to remain in private hands. Unfortunately, the chapel, the citizens group, was not able to hold up its end of the bargain, and the chapel was demolished in 1918 for a post office. To add insult to injury, the subsequent Tammany administration of John Hyland dissolved McAneny's committee on the city plan, and the city did not get a planning commission until 1938, which is much later than what happened to a lot of other cities around the country. Now, just to sort of fast forward a little bit, in 1909, McAneny was elected borough president. In 1913, he ran again for office for president of the Board of Aldermen, which is a position that's now known as the public advocate. So it was kind of a vice mayor type position. At the beginning of 1916, he resigned that office. May have been sensing that political winds were shifting. The reform administration that had had so much energy and enthusiasm was running out of gas. Or maybe he just needed to make more money. He had a large family with six children. And he became, and he left and was hired by the New York Times as a manager on the business side of that, of the newspaper. Sourcing paper, actually, for the newspaper. Then a few years later, he became a manager of a title company. And in the 1920s, McAneny began to return to public life. He was chairman of the State Transit Commission. When Jimmy Walker was mayor in the 1920s, McAneny was brought back into the city administration to run another planning committee. When he was still unsuccessful in convincing the city administration to institutionalize planning, he left the city government and joined the Regional Plan Association, which, with the help of private philanthropy, was trying to do for the entire tri-state region what a generation of planners and reformers had failed to convince the city to do for itself, to institutionalize city planning. And in 1930, McAneny was named the RPA's president, a position that he held for 10 years, and in which he spread the gospel of planning and zoning throughout the suburbs, and thousands of municipalities adopted planning and zoning commissions because of his work. Now, in 1939, he became chairman of the World's Fair Corporation, which was sort of an honorary role that was given to him as part of his position as president of the RPA. And in connection with his efforts to draw World's Fair tourists downtown, he became involved in a campaign to try to commemorate the 150th anniversary of the Washington inaugural, which was going to happen in 1939, right at the same time as the fair was just getting started out of the place. So that inaugural, of course, of Washington took place right here on this very site that we are sitting today on April 30, 1789. And in mid-April, and at that time, and there's sort of the Washington inaugural, this took place not in this particular building, which was built in the 1830s, but in an earlier building that was on this site and was unfortunately demolished just a couple of years after Washington was inaugurated. By the 1930s, this building it had been constructed as a customs house, and by the 1930s, it was operating basically as surplus federal office space. So you see someone advertising passport photos out front with this sandwich board. That's because the federal passport office was inside this building. So in mid-April of 1939, McAneny's contacts in Washington, D.C. Convinced the Secretary of the Interior, Harold Ickes, to designate this building as a National Historic Monument, using the authority that had been granted to Ickes by the 1935 Historic Sites Act. Now, on the anniversary date of April 30, this happened very quickly, in just a couple of weeks, McAneny himself addressed a crowd from the steps of this building, right out front, to recount Washington's inauguration, promote the World's Fair, proclaim Ickes' designation, and announce that a permanent historical museum would be established on this site with government support. So by September, McAneny and his associates, working closely with employees of the National Park Service, had created a new organization named the Federal Hall Memorial Associates. And the associates in the National Park Service would collaborate on running this site for nearly five decades until the associates dissolved in the 1980s. And this became particularly important during World War II, even though they only controlled actually the basement of the building, the rest of it was all still office space. But they would have entertainers like Helen Hayes here, who would come to promote the sale of war bonds. They would have patriotic celebrations out front and downstairs. And McAneny, who you can see right here, participated very much in that. So, interestingly, while this was all going on, and as McAneny was preparing to commemorate the Washington inaugural and preparing to start the museum that was going to exist in this building, he and other veteran reformers were also facing down Robert Moses in a fight that Anthony earlier referenced over the Battery and over Castle Clinton that would last over a decade. So in 1938, Moses had proposed to build an enormous suspension bridge from Battery Park to Brooklyn with massive approaches that would have blocked views of the harbor and diminished Battery Park. The Regional Planning Association, led by McAneny, had coordinated a group of opponents to this proposal, although their alternative would have been equally damaging, actually, as it would have widened the Brooklyn Bridge, built an elevated highway up through Chinatown and across Soho over to the Holland Tunnel. Moses really wanted this bridge as sort of a commemoration of himself. In his bullying way, he derided McAneny in a public hearing as an extinct volcano who could never run for public office again, and an exhumed mummy. I have been wondering lately what it would be like if Moses had access to Twitter. I can only imagine the kinds of insults that he would have put Donald Trump to shame, I think. Now, as many of you probably know, thanks to intercession by Eleanor Roosevelt, federal government kiboshed all talk of bridges here, and instead gave the city a low-interest loan to build a tunnel instead, which became the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel. And Moses was not really happy about this. And so 2 years later, Moses abruptly announced that due to the tunnel construction, which was going to run from Battery Park here down to Brooklyn, he was going to close the aquarium that had been in the park for about 50 years and demolish a structure which was much older, built in 1811, known as Castle Clinton. Known to us as Castle Clinton, known to them perhaps as Castle Garden or Fort Clinton. And McAneny, who was really stung, I think, by Moses' personal attacks in the bridge battle, was more than willing to engage in a new fight that would launch him out of the orbit of planning and into the final stage of his career as a full-time preservationist. Earlier in his career, many of the attitudes and positions that Moses was criticized for could also be attributed to George McAneny. So Robert Moses had ignored opposition to his projects and disregarded their impacts on impoverished and political powerless communities. So did George McAneny. He didn't care about the opposition to his street widening. He disregarded it. Moses felt that it was necessary to create new institutional arrangements that would insulate people in positions of power from the vicissitudes of public opinion. And so did George McAneny. And if you look at his speeches from the 1910s, McAneny has always complained about public opinion never getting about the public and the press never giving elected officials a chance to carry out their programs. It's just constant harping. Moses also advocated large-scale redevelopment that would destroy and displace thousands of people. And so did George McAneny. The only one that he really got to implement was the Greenwich Village widening or extension of 7th Avenue with the widening of Barrack Street, but there were other projects that he had in his mind and on the drawing board that he just didn't have the funding to implement. And also, McAneny believed in and acted on all of these ideas before Moses ever held any power at all. We shouldn't think that Moses originated sort of the idea of bulldozing his way through the city. Not at all. But McAneny found it advantageous to adopt these kinds of positions when he was at the height of his political influence. But in the 1930s, when McAneny was kind of on the outs and wasn't part of the municipal government anymore, and Moses was the mayor's construction coordinator and held a host of other titles at the same time, I think McAneny started to have a gradual realization about the use of power to control the shaping of the city. And he came to see that he was going to have to use the tools of protest and delay that he had earlier criticized back when he was borough president to prevent Moses from making what McAneny believed were serious mistakes. And the case that I'm going to, one of the cases that I'm trying to make in this manuscript is that this realization, I think, propelled McAneny to the leadership of New York's preservation movement, and then to the leadership of the post-war preservation movement nationally. And in that position, he inspired the next generation of preservation activists. So I think that this is really a case where sort of a New York story had a lasting influence, both in the city, but also on the nation as a whole. So when Moses announced that he was going to close this building, he had authority to close to shut down the aquarium right away. Now, the loss of this aquarium, which had been there for several decades, caused a lot of consternation in the city. The director of the New York Historical Society, on a radio program, said, "Save the aquarium," and he compared America's destruction of historic buildings like the aquarium to the Nazi blitz on Britain that was ongoing at the time. The New York Herald Tribune was very nostalgic over the combination of what it said was the tang of the sea and ships and a visit to the sea's denizens that the Battery and the aquarium together on this site jointly offered. it's clear that the aquarium held a special place in the hearts of New Yorkers at the time in a way that we can only imagine today. And the editors of the New York of the Herald Tribune actually suggested that rather than saving the building, what was really important was to save the aquarium on this particular site, kind of the inverse of architectural preservation. But the reality was, in 1941, the aquarium was a lost cause. The Zoological Society that operated it had no interest in a fight with Robert Moses. And besides that, McAneny and his friends in the National Park Service, which he had made a lot of connections there while working on the preservation of this building, starting in 1939, they were not really interested in preserving the aquarium either. What they wanted to do was to create another monument to the early days of the American Republic in Lower Manhattan. And to do this, they wanted to restore the aquarium structure to its original appearance as a fort. They wanted something that would look sort of like this. And so in 1941, the National Park Service asked Robert Moses to remove the aquarium superstructure from the building. This whole structure, which people thought of as historic. And Moses was only too happy to comply with this because he said, hey, this is the first step in taking down the whole building. And what he wanted to do, he said, was to create a line of sight from here straight out to the Statue of Liberty. And this fort was in the way. So McAneny became, in 1942, having left the RPA, McAneny became the president of the American Scenic and Historic Preservation Society, which we can call ASHP. A venerable New York-based preservation group that had saved early buildings, early city buildings such as Hamilton Grange, and also historic sites upstate. So by this time, McAneny is working full-time on preservation, the first time in his life, through ASHEAPS and the Federal Hall Memorial Associates, which he continues to be the chairman of. During the war years, although Moses had destroyed the aquarium, he could not demolish the fort itself due to shortages of material and labor. So after the war ended, McAneny began traveling almost weekly to Washington or Albany, pressing for needed legislation while helping to coordinate lawsuits to stop Moses from proceeding with the destruction once Moses had access again to the labor he would have needed to try to demolish the fort. And there are a lot of stories about how the destruction was halted at the last minute by injunctions from a judge, which you can read about in Tony's book. But finally, in 1950, this fort, which now had been, of course, stripped of its accoutrements and embellishments, and it had been stripped back down to something resembling what it might have looked like back in the early days, was designated as a national monument by Congress, and the federal government provided funding to commence restoration. So, as both the Federal Hall and Castle Clinton preservation campaigns were going on, McAneny was developing deep ties with high-ranking civil servants in the National Park Service. He was working at both of these sites throughout this time. And he forged an especially close working relationship with the historian Ronald Lee, who conceived of the idea for a new national organization that would unite the nation's local historic preservation societies like ASHEAPS with sort of national groups and the National Park Service to meet the challenge of post-war preservation when large-scale development of homes and for returning veterans and just general economic expansion were overwhelming both the cities and the countryside. So in October of 1946, just as the Castle Clinton fight was moving into high gear, McAneny and the New York architect Erich Kugler were the first local leaders that Lee turned to with his idea for a new national group. And Lee sketched out a proposal to McAneny that called for a tripartite working group to be formed with representatives of preservation organizations, representatives of municipal and state governments, and representatives of the federal government. They even discussed the possibility that ASHEAPS, the local New York preservation group, would sort of become this new national organization. But in 1947, a new group, the National Council on Historic Buildings and Sites, was formed in Washington, D.C., with top preservationists and planners to be in its leading role, including McAneny as its chairman. And this new group, led by McAneny, by Kenneth Chorley, who was the leading preservationist for historic Williamsburg, and Ulysses Grant III, who was a planner of parks and historic monuments in the Washington, D.C., National Capital Region, would create what became the National Trust for Historic Preservation. So McAneny, by this point, is almost 90 years old. Over 80 years old. And in 1950, he, as kind of an aged man by this time, made one of his last public appearances at the fourth annual meeting of the National Council. And this is not actually that meeting, but this is an award that McAneny was receiving from a local patriotic group right here on the site of Federal Hall in 1949, so right around the same time. And what McAneny told the National Council in 1950 at its fourth annual meeting was, save the old places. He said, whatever you yourselves are interested in, and whatever ventures of salvation you have, consider the wisdom of waiting everlastingly, if necessary, to get what you want as we did, referencing the Castle Clinton Battery Bridge fight with Moses that took over a decade. And so McAneny here was encouraging the preservation community to adopt his characteristic persistence and patience, and to use the checks and balances of the American constitutional framework to force delays in the process and to obtain victories. And I think that embedded within his pep talk to the preservationists in 1950 from all over the nation was also a recognition of the emerging diversity within the preservation community. So most of McAneny's preservation battles, from St. John's Chapel in 1915 to City Hall, which I didn't mention earlier, but he was responsible for finding funding for a historically authentic reconstruction of City Hall to be the interior of City Hall to appear roughly as it did when it was built back in 1811. To the preservation of this site, to the preservation of Castle Clinton. All of these preservation battles were essentially designed to save relics of the early Republic in New York City, so that people would remember the hallowed era of the Founding Fathers, and these sites would sort of be put on a pedestal. But he recognized, though, by 1950, that other preservationists might have very different goals. And in telling people to preserve whatever it is that they feel is worth preserving. And in fact, a new kind of preservation was emerging all over the country and here in the city in the 1940s and 1950s. So beginning with the attempt to save the row houses that surrounded Washington Square Park, a cause to which McAneny lent his name in the late 1940s, preservation was making a historic shift from elite campaigns for civic monuments to neighborhood-based activism. And so at the end of his life, McAneny was becoming a champion of neighborhood groups that resembled the ones on the Lower East Side that he had shut down four decades earlier. These newly empowered activists would become the standard bearers of a re-energized preservation movement. They would ultimately win this city its landmarks law, whose 50th anniversary we have just celebrated last year, as well as countless other preservation victories in other cities around the nation. And I think that McAneny had had an important hand in bringing a New York experience and perspective to those fights. And so as both a planner and a preservationist, I think McAneny was really a pioneer in both fields. A pioneer planner in the 1910s, and by the 1940s, really on the leading edge of preservation. And I think that we owe it to ourselves, you know, living in New York, to really understand and appreciate that legacy, and see that there are other figures in our history besides Robert Moses and his nemesis, Jane Jacobs, to which we could look back to as examples of people who were active in shaping the growth and development of the city, and also to see examples of how people can change over time as they come to realize sort of the error of their ways. And McAneny was someone who was almost uniquely able to do that. He was constantly able to shift positions, and I think that speaks to his fundamental orientation of the planner as coordinator, not the planner from looking down on high saying, we're going to do it this way, we're going to do it my way or the highway, but rather the planner working between various interest groups, between various ideologies, and between various kinds of technical expertise to try to shape the city in what eventually, for him, I think became an egalitarian way. And I think that's something that's worth thinking about.
So what we want to do now is just start the conversation, following up on what we just heard, and I'm going to open it up to you to join us, because I think there'll probably be more interesting questions that you have. But my first question is, when you started this, you, I think, kind of knew McAneny a bit, probably from the Power Broker and the like, and Michael, you certainly knew of McAneny. What surprised you in your research as you were doing this, and Michael, what surprised you learning of his research about McAneny that kind of, as I say, put him in a different light, or just was kind of a big aha?
Well, one of the things that it was really sort of a gradual process of putting the different pieces together. I don't know if there was really a particular aha moment, but sort of really thinking about him in relation to Robert Moses actually was one of the keys for me to begin to understand what kind of figure he was. Because I was actually presenting on McAneny back a year ago at a conference, and I was presenting on his extension of 7th Avenue in Greenwich Village and the destruction of that cause, which actually is a whole talk in itself, and so I didn't have time to get to sort of do more of it. But somebody asked me, how is this different from Robert Moses? And I said, well, in some ways it's not really that different, but because McAneny is espousing the same kinds of philosophy at the time that Moses was espousing. But then I realized, later on, as a preservationist, he was really saying some very different kinds of things. And that really started, and sometimes we tend to think of historical figures as being consistent throughout their lives, but I started to realize, actually, probably not. I mean, probably actually he did have a change of heart in knowing that Moses was attacked him in the way that he did. I really think that there was sort of a transformation that occurred. And that sort of started to make me see that this was almost sort of a story that you could tell about, not only about the transformation of a city, but also the transformation of a person in the way that he managed to stay relevant and really become a preservationist, which he didn't necessarily start out as.
The story of redemption.
Well, of course I'm biased about this, but the thing that struck me is the parallels with Andrew Reid, who was sort of, I would say, was the torchbearer that McAneny took the torch from in a lot of ways. Their lives, the parallels are quite striking. In that they both basically started as planners and then they evolved into preservationists. And sort of lesson, it seems that preservation is an old man's game. Don't take that personally, but that's
seems to be the
sort of the trend, at least with these two unsung preservationists. A question I have, if I sort of may diverge from your question, is where Green's career and McAneny's career are not parallel. And Andrew Green, by the way, for those of you who don't know, he was the founder of the American Scenic and Historic Preservation Society. By the way, I never used the term bash heaps. This is the first time it's left my lips.
But that is indeed how they were called.
They were called that, but I will not call it that. I think it's a degradation of, you know, what is arguably the first formal historic preservation society in the nation, founded by Andrew Green. But in the very name, American Scenic and Historic Preservation Society, you see an element which was large, which was a big part of Andrew Green's psyche and the founding of that organization's intention, which doesn't seem to be present in McAneny's career, is parks. And I'm wondering if does McAneny have any sort of motivation to create, build, enhance parks or scenic places?
Well, you know, McAneny, it's kind of interesting. McAneny was a city guy. He went up to Bolton Landing up on Lake George every summer, but apparently he couldn't wait to get back to New York City. He was not sort of a parks of nature kind of figure. People would write to him and ask him to help preserve parks in the city. He did work up in Inwood Hill to purchase land for the city that had previously been owned by the hospital and the commons, other stuff that was up there. And he worked on that a little bit, but it just wasn't really his orientation. By the 1930s, the Regional Plan Association is promoting its sort of regional agenda. But even there, you constantly see when his focus is really on development, buildings, infrastructure, parks are kind of what you put between the buildings, I guess. I guess you actually see that in a lot of the plans that he adopted. I mean, I think he appreciated green space as something to look at, but it wasn't really his passion.
McAneny's early work was very disruptive of what we would value today as preservationists. But at that moment in time, the motivation being so much these kind of sites of founding fathers and iconic sites and neighborhoods weren't really in the picture. So in a sense, he was in line with kind of the preservation thinking of that time. And then you point out that at the end of his career, he had morphed to be where preservation was beginning to come, the neighborhood focus, and more in today's tradition. Which is, you know, interesting that he's kind of following the movement. Was he leading? I mean, was he following? Was he open to what he was hearing and experiencing and talking to others and reflecting that? How do you see more of this evolution in him?
Well, you know, he's when I first started studying McAneny, he never struck me as somebody who really was a visionary and had sort of this, come up with a vision in his own head about where the city could go, or sort of how society should arrange itself. But rather, he seemed to be very astute in understanding and being able to pick up ideas from other people and meld them or try to implement them. And he did that with city planning in the 1910s. City planning was not something that George McAneny invented. Zoning was not something that McAneny invented. But he understood that they were things that the city could, that sort of the municipal administration could push. And that it would be possible to implement them, and that they would serve needs at that time. So I think that he saw the same thing happening in the 1940s in a way. Like he saw that there were people who were coalescing around the idea of saving those row houses around Washington Square Park, and he agreed to sign on to that. I think that he recognized that there were a lot of different preservation objectives that people had. He wasn't necessarily going to tell them. He wasn't necessarily going to tell activists, but this is, you know, only this type of site is working. What he wanted to do was not good. That's not good preservation. That wasn't any style at all. Rather, he would recognize that there was a need out there. There are people who are coming up with creative ways to address that need. He thinks that his experience fighting Moses, filing lawsuits, lobbying the legislature, getting legislation passed, just being very tenacious, he thinks that that's going to be an example for all of these people. And he sort of sees himself as a leader in that way. And I think that the preservationists who were involved in the National Council at the time appreciated that. And they saw that that was an inspiration that they could take from George McAneny.
Actually, I think you could argue that the preservation techniques that he used battling Moses are still the foundational techniques used by preservationists today in when up against a project or something that that isn't going in the direction they want. So I think you're right about that.
Well, I'm gonna answer that. Yeah. The fights he fought about seem to have been fought in the press, in meetings, in the halls of the legislature. From your presentation and your monograph, I don't think he was out there chaining himself to bulldozers. Am I correct in that? That hadn't advanced quite to that point. The famed Grand Central Station protests, the placards and picket lines, right?
That wasn't his style, really. He actually is one of the only people that you probably will ever find that thought that LaGuardia was a bad mayor, because he thought that LaGuardia was too much of a populist. And he didn't think that those kinds of techniques, those kinds of very in-your-face techniques were suitable for somebody in his position. Maybe he started to change his attitude toward the end of his life. That just was not how things were done for most of his time in office. The people who were leading preservation campaigns were, as Tony says, the civic gentry. And they were people who operated behind closed doors, memos and letters to the editor.
They were radicalized by Moses. I mean, they were basically a bunch of well-behaved civic guys, most of them. And it was kind of Moses pushed them so far that they kind of found themselves in, I think, kind of uncharacteristic roles in having to battle. But I wanted to ask you, because when you look at the American Seating Historic Preservation Society, is for people who know the history of preservation, I mean, it's one of the big things when you look at its evolution.
I'm glad you think so.
Well, absolutely. And there are two, and so you've got your man, Green, who starts it, and then we've got McAneny, who kind of led it at this key moment. Those are kind of the two high points of that organization, in a sense. And did McAneny kind of help revitalize it when he became president, or was it robust through there? I mean, how was his role in that society?
Yeah, I would say it's the American City Historic Preservation Society, it kind of lived along. I will say that. It was a strangely conceived and executed organization. It was, I think, a pioneering institution in the concept of a public-private organization. And you know more about this than I do, so maybe correct me if I'm going too far with this contention. The American Seating and Historic Preservation Society was chartered by the legislature of the state of New York, but it was essentially a private organization. And at the time, believe it or not, this was in the 1890s, the mid-1890s, the state of New York had no formal parks department and had no formal means of preserving historic sites. Just jumping ahead, one of the big fights that Robert Moses would have with the American Seating and Historic Preservation Society would be to take control of the parks, put them in a unified park system, and in order to do that, he needed to pluck away from the American Seating and Historic Preservation Society the parks under which they were still controlled. Right? So Andrew Green conceives this organization whereby a private institution, Miscione, can come in, take custodianship of parks and historic places and historic sites, and run them. And basically, you serve, this is kind of important, I think, serve as a channel for private philanthropists to support these parks and historic sites. So, somebody would write a check or sign over a deed to the American Secret Historic Preservation Society, they would create a park, they would finance a park, and that would not, that those monies would not come out of the New York State Legislature, right? So basically they were this in between, so eventually this all becomes formalized under Robert Jones, the project leads that out, but this was a pioneering thing at the time. So, I'm sorry, I strained them. So the American Secret, yeah, so in, I would say after Green's passing in 1903, 1904, the society kind of limps along. It probably has its greatest achievements in creating these parks or formalizing the custodianship of these parks, like Niagara Falls, like Letchworth State Park, like Stony Point, and in my opinion, one of the most important things, in Hamilton Grange. If it wasn't for them, Hamilton Grange.
We always have to bring things back to Hamilton to make it pop.
Sure. But the fact of the matter is, they're not really.
So when McAneny comes in,
and especially when the whole Robert Moses conflict with the parks that I just mentioned, with the battles against McAneny, that's when this organization really comes back into the fore. It was always back there. And by the way, another thing to its credit, one of the things that it did, and I think you'll agree with me on this, is it gave sort of a home, if only a virtual home, to these preservationists and this preservation movement. One of the great things they would do is every year they put out an annual report. And in that annual report, because they consider themselves of national scale, they would chronicle all of these movements going around in New York State, in the United States, and even in the world that required the attention of power brokers to save these places.
Which was why they were thought of potentially to become the national group that became the National Trust. So, one last question for me, then we're going to go to the audience. And in a sense, most people's understanding of kind of these issues from the 50s and 60s has kind of been boiled down to Robert Moses and Jane Jacobs, which in my mind seems to kind of have, they've taken the air out of the room in a sense, and so figures like McAneny and other civic leaders kind of fall by the wayside. So I'm just curious, do you think that, how do we begin to insert these other historic figures to make that a richer, fuller story that has, in a sense, become this Reader's Digest? It was all about, you're either a Moses person or you're a Jacobian, and that's kind of all there was.
Well, it's really hard because it's such a great story, the battle between Moses and Jacobs. And they seem to have diverging perspectives. But I think we can recognize that they have a few things in common as well that are not so commonly recognized. They both were, it's been argued anyway, I wouldn't probably argue about this, but they both were trying to make the city safe for the middle class. They just had different ways of doing it. They also both, from different perspectives, really disliked planning and planners. They both denigrated planners. Robert Moses called them long-haired planners, and sort of from the authoritarian right perspective. And Jane Jacobs, didn't appreciate planners and thought that they could control everything from the top down. A figure like George McAneny is a champion of planning. And he's a champion of the idea that a planner can coordinate all of these diverse interests. I mean, in a way, he's kind of doing what Jane Jacobs was hoping would happen in a city by sort of
appreciating the diversity of the city. And so I think that if we start to examine, if we start to say, well, maybe Jacobs and Moses were not such complete polar opposites as you thought, then perhaps there's also room for other figures who can come in and complicate the picture even more.
And in one sense, we're lucky my good friend Roberta Gratz isn't here tonight, who would probably argue very vociferously about no shared space between the two. Michael?
I would just think that the problem is that that preservationists have redefined preservation. It's really what it is. Where your topic left off. Greens, the McAneny's, or preservationists of the old school, they had history with a capital H front and center to the efforts that they are preserving. Today, that's not the case. Now we preserve architecture, we preserve aesthetics, we preserve culture, right?
And this is one of the oddities of preservationist history in the sense that the two streams of thought that came together, the landmarks law, the people who were motivated by sites and their history and the importance of keeping that alive, and then the people who came out of kind of the art movement and the Chicago World's Fair, the aesthetic motivation, is that both of those came together in the landmarks law, but at the end of the day, even though history started, the actual application and operation of the law was really been driven by the aesthetic consideration and the architectural distinction. And to this day, it's still a lot harder to preserve a building whose interest and value is solely historic or cultural, unless it's got a little architectural something going for it. But maybe that's a good place to open up for the audience, who's been very patient with letting us have fun up here. So, questions from the audience?
I'm wondering if McAneny ever talked, like when he was older, if he ever talked about the widening, the extension of 7th Avenue and the widening of Barrack. Did he ever change his mind about doing that?
You kind of recognize the mistake that he did.
I haven't ever seen anything that where in which he explicitly acknowledges making a mistake. He seems to be the kind of person that's always looking forward, not looking back. So I think it's more reading between the lines that I think he changed his position. He in 1949 was interviewed by the Columbia Oral History Office, actually the first interview they ever did. He gives his thoughts on a lot of things. He never talks about having made mistakes. But I think if you look at some of his other writings, you can kind of, there's an implication there.
In my memory is that oral history that he devoted the vast amount of it to talking about Casablanca.
Yeah, he devotes a lot of it to that. He devotes a lot of it to giving his unvarnished opinions about different political figures. It's entertaining, yeah.
Other thought questions, yes?
Question. I'm not sure the extent to which he was involved in picking architects because it was such a convoluted process by which they were chosen. He did hire, I believe it was Daniel Burnham, if I'm not mistaken, to design a plan, not just for buildings, but for a whole streetscape. It was going to ram. They were going to ram a boulevard along the crest of the hill, all the way up to Inwood Hill, and then build a bridge from the, not from like down below where Robert Moses ended up building his bridge, but right on the top of that hill over to the Bronx. It would have completely obliterated the natural landscape. He did retain, I believe it was Daniel Burnham to do that. But in terms of other architects, that's something I need to research.
They don't have a question. I've got a question. You occasionally, we now know his career and the art of his accomplishments. I'd like to know a little bit more about the guy. You mentioned his style, for example. So that's one aspect of him personally. Another thing I found fascinating, we you know this term you use, and I love it, the civic gentry, right? Gentry implies sort of a patrician moneyed background. This guy wasn't even college educated, right? He was from New Jersey of all places. And so he sort of managed to mingle in these circles from a kind of a little bit of a hard-scrabble background, part journalist, part manager, part politician. You mentioned he was married, had a bunch of kids. Give us a little sense of
did his wife bring some social dimension at all?
Yeah, well, he,
it's interesting that, what I find interesting about it is that he comes from New Jersey. Now, some people have said that he came from a poor background. I don't think that's quite the case, given his father's relative prominence in Jersey City. But he definitely was not from Civic Gentry of New York City. And but interestingly, he seemed to have this felicity from a very young age with people who were of a much higher social status than he was. And I don't know exactly where that comes from. He's sent out by these newspapers, as I mentioned, to report on socialites at all of these summer and winter resorts when he's like 20 years old. And then he is somebody who gets who is noticed by prominent figures, George William Curtis, Carl Schurz, and is introduced into their society that way, kind of political society. Carl Schurz introduces him to the Jacobis, who were a very prominent pair of pediatricians, probably the most important doctors in New York in the 19th century. And he marries their daughter. So he kind of marries into this. At the same time, he's always, I think, financially pressed, because his father died in 1892 when he was like 23 years old. And he actually has to pay for tuition, even though he never went to college. He has to pay for tuition for his younger brothers to go to boarding schools, he had a brother who went to Columbia University, and then he's married, and then he has all these kids to raise. And he's constantly, like in the archives you can see, where he's constantly writing letters to people saying, I'm sorry, I can't contribute money to your cause this year. He's constantly going to family functions. Maybe it's an excuse to get out of things. I don't know. He's always writing letters where he's saying, I can't attend this because I'm going to be at Lake George, or I've got a family function to go to, or this, that, or the other. So he's clearly a family man. And I'd like to also know more about George McAneny, the sort of father and wife and the husband, as well as a sort of political figure.
Is there extant family?
Yeah, there are.
Are any in the audience? Do we have any descendants in the audience?
No, but his time in the book and in George and his connection with his connection with the Schurz family.
We'll make sure we get this on our way.
And the Jacobi family was very important. I mean, Schurz and Jacobi. 48 years, they left Germany, and the revolution failed, and they came over here and established themselves as serious reformers. And so he marries into a family, which is very progressive. And of course, the fact that Abraham Jacobi's wife was a doctor as well at that time was totally unheard of. And so he really is in this milieu, which is in terms of Jacobi had this large estate in Mobile Bay, and he actually built on that estate a home for Carl Schurz. Schurz didn't have a home on his own, but Jacobi built that home, and they were they were both busy and doing a lot of things, but they spent a great deal of time there. And that was also steamers and
volume two will have to be George McAneny, the man. I think we're going to bring this to a close and final question. Oh, sorry.
But you know that Afterward wrote a letter when they named it Polo Square saying it should be named McAneny Square. And he trashed it, genuinely trashed it. Foley called him all sorts of names and said, and through the same.
Barb was a huge fan of McAneny, and the correspondence between them is kind of great fun because one is saying the other should have the credit, the other is writing back saying, no, no, you were the one who really made it all happen. So great admiration there. It's always appropriate to end the program talking about Albert Barb, some of our perspectives. So thank you all for coming. I think there's water and minor munchies around the corner, right, if people want to continue the conversation. So thank you for joining us tonight.